Very good morning to all. In last session, we have completed various topics on process and threat chapter. We have seen introductory part of process, what do you mean by thread. After that, we have seen process state diagram. In that, we have seen what are the main state of process and how we are transferring from one state to another. Further, we have seen what do you mean by scheduling, what are the main objective, as well as we have seen two scheduling algorithm like HCFS and SJF, right? So two more is remaining in this chapter, like priority based scheduling and round robin. So today we will go through these two pending algorithm, right? So again, we will quickly revise a topic which we have already covered in last session. So scheduler are special system software which handle process scheduling in various ways. Their main task is to select the job to be submitted into the system and to decide which process to run. That means in scheduling task, they are selecting one by one job to enter into the processing part, right? But that selection part is depend on the various algorithm which you are following. So in the last we have seen FCFS. So again, what do you mean by FCFS? First come, first serve. So in that, whichever process come first, scheduler is picked up that particular process and we will run complete that particular process. After that, we have seen SJF. So again, SJF is having two type of scheduling algorithm, preemptive and non-preemptive. So SJF is basically nothing but stands for shortest job first. So in that, shortest job parameter we are selecting from the burst time, right? Whichever process is having lesser execution time, that particular process we can call as a shortest job. So in that, we are having two type of variant. First one is the preemptive and second one is the non-preemptive. So again, in preemptive process, whenever we are having some higher priority process, at that time we are just pause our current execution and for that we are allowing new process to enter into the execution. Whereas in the non-preemptive scheduling, until a process itself and their working, we are not able to force, or you can say we are not able to pause their work, right? So anyhow, we are just ending that execution and after that we are allowing any new process to enter into the execution, right? So that is the meaning of preemptive and non-preemptive. So today we will see this concept with context of priority and round robin scheduling. Now whenever we are executing any scheduling algorithm, we need to care for this parameter. The first one is CPU utilization. We need to have maximum CPU utilization. Again, this objective we have already seen in the last session. The second term is throughput. Throughput is nothing but you can say efficiency of your process execution. The third thing is turnaround time. So turnaround time is nothing but you can say a difference between completion time of a particular process and arrival time of a particular process. That means formula of TAT is equal to completion time, or you can say finish time, minus arrival time. The fourth objective is minimum waiting time. So again, we are having formula for that. Waiting time is nothing but turnaround time minus burst time. So this all parameter we are having in the numerics. And the last one, that is minimum response time. We require our process to respond in a minimal waiting time, right? So that is, we can consider as a one of the objective. We require minimum response time for each and every process. Now quickly move towards the scheduling algorithm part. So we will see priority based scheduling. It is again having two type of scheduling. First one is preemptive and second one is the non-preemptive. So what do you mean by priority based scheduling? A priority, that is nothing but you can say one integer number is associated with each and every process. Let's see this thing with help of one numeric. So here you can see we are having total 5 process, P1, P2, P3, P4 and P5. We are having burst time of each and every process. Again, What do you mean by burst time? Burst time is nothing but you can say as a, it is execution time of a particular process, right? With these two parameter in priority scheduling, we are having one new parameter called priority value, right? So to understand this priority value, you can use any of the variant. Like if number is low, that means you are having higher priority, or else if number is high, that means you are having higher priority. Any phenomena you can take for your example, there is nothing harm, but whenever you are starting any example, you need to mention, or else it is already mentioned like this: if number is low, then you need to consider higher priority. So here I am following this particular phenomena, that if number is low, that means higher priority. So for example, process P2 is having priority 1. That means 1 is indicating higher priority. So we are starting our procedure from that thing only, right? So first of all, we are executing non-preemptive priority by scheduling. That means meanwhile, we are not pause our execution. We just need to complete our complete execution part, right? So from the file process, we are not interested on the arrival time. Why? Because it is not given. That means we are assuming each and every process is having same arrival time called 0, right? So which process is having higher priority? As we have discussed, P2. So we will start our execution from P2 itself, right? So we are assuming P2 is arriving at 0, and it is require 1 unit as a burst time to complete their execution. So in the Gantt chart itself, you are able to get this idea. P2 is started at 0 and completed at 1. After that, which process is having higher priority? P5. So P5 we are initializing at 1 arrival time, and it is required 5 units to complete. So it is started at 1 and require 5 units. That means P5 is completed at 6. After that, process P1 is having priority called 3. So we are executing P1. For that, P1 is starting at 6 and it is required 10 units to complete. That means we are able to finish our P1 at 16, right? After P1, process P3 is having higher priority. So we are starting P3 at 16 and it is required 2 units to complete their execution. So we are ending P3 at 18, and same way P4 is require 1 unit of burst time. So P4 we are initializing at 18 and it is completed after 1 unit, that is 19. So like this we are able to generate this Gantt chart, right? And now rest of the procedure will remain same as we have done in the case of FCFS and SJF. What we need to generate from this Gantt chart? We need to generate table for the completion time, turnaround time and waiting time, right? So here completion time of P1 is 16, for P2 is 1, for P3 is 18, for P4 is 19 and for P5 is 6. So from this completion time, you are having idea about turnaround time and waiting time. So again, recall what is the formula of turnaround time. It is nothing but the difference between completion time and arrival time. So from that you are having turnaround time of each and every process, and the second is waiting time. So again, what is the formula of waiting time? Turnaround time minus burst time. So generate turnaround time and waiting time for each and every process and quickly verify your answer with these two. So I hope you are getting answer like this. Average turnaround time is 12 and average waiting time is 8.2. Now again, there is one more example on preemptive priority based scheduling. Right now we have seen non-preemptive. Now this is the case of preemptive. That means if we have executed any process for some time interval, and after that if we are having any new process in the picture from the arrival time, then we are executing that process if it is having higher priority than our current process. That means, let's suppose start with this example itself. As I have said earlier in last session, though we are executing or referring any algorithm, but if we are having some process at a zero arrival time, then irrespective of algorithm, we just going to peak first that particular process. So here P1 is arriving at a zero. So initially we will start our execution from P1 itself, right? So P1 is having priority 3. So for that, actually we are having some other process in the queue which is having higher priority, but though P1 is arriving at a zero, we are going through P1 first. So we have started our process with help of P1. It is arriving at a zero, but here we are not completely executing P1. Why? Because we are following preemptive priority based scheduling. So initially we have just executed P1 by one unit. That means we are starting at a zero and ending at a P at a one. And at a 1, we are verifying, is there any process which is arriving at a 1, as well as that process is having higher priority than P1? If yes, then we are executing with that process. That means, at a 1, is there any process which is arriving? You can get this idea from the arrival time itself. That means, yes, P2 is arriving at 1. Now what is the second thing we need to discuss? If P2 is having higher priority than P1, if yes, then we can execute P2, but if no, that means we need to carry with P1 itself. So yes, P2 is having priority called 1. That means P2 is having higher priority than P1. So we are executing with P1. Now after one unit execution of P1, that means at a time quantum, or you can say at a 2, we are again verifying, is there any process which is arriving at a 2 and it is having higher priority than P2. So at arrival time 2, we are having one process called P3, but it is not having higher priority than P2. So we are just carry with our P2 itself, right? That means now we have executed for 2 units. So we are starting at a 1 and we are executing by 2 units. That means now we are having P2 at a 3, right? We are pause our process P2 at a 3 completion time. And again we are verifying, is there any process which is arriving at a 3? Yes, we are having P4. And P4 is having higher priority than P2, again no. That means we are not finding any process which can beat execution of P2. That means we are completely executing our P2 first. So it is having 4 as a bus time. So we are completely executing this P2, and that is why we are ending execution of P2 at a 5, right? Now you can see at a 5 arrival time, we are having all process in the ready queue. So either we can execute P1 as it is pending, right? We have just executed P1 for one unit of time. So obviously it is pending, as well as we can also execute P3, as well as we can execute P4. But which process we should pick? We should pick a process which is having higher priority. So as P2 is completed, the second process which is having higher priority, that is P4. So in the Gantt chart itself, you can see after execution of P2, we are executing P4. And as it is required 5 units to execute, we are starting at a 5 and ending at a 10. So after that, third high priority process in the queue is P1. So we, as P1, we have executed for 1 unit of time. Now 7 unit is pending to execute, right? So we are starting at a 10 and it is required 7 unit to complete their execution. That means P1 we are ending at a 17. And now the last process, P3, it is required 9 unit to complete. That means at a 17 we are starting and at a 26 we are ending our execution, right? So like this you are having your Gantt chart, and from this you need to analyze completion time, up from that turnaround time and waiting time. So here, what is the completion time of P1? As I have said, you just need to focus on the rightmost part of Gantt chart, because we are having on the different level we are having same process. Like at initial part we have also executed P1, meanwhile we have also executed P1, but what is the fix, or you can say actual completion time of P1, that is 17, right? Same way, completion time of P2 is 5, completion time of P3 is 26, and completion time of P4 is 10. So again, calculate turnaround time and waiting time from this and just verify your answer with average turnaround time and average waiting time. So I hope you are getting this answer, right? So now the second scheduling algorithm, that is round robin algorithm. So in that, basically we are using value of time quantum. That means, let's suppose we are keeping value of time quantum is equal to 4. So after 4 unit of execution, anyhow we need to pause our process. In just, we are allowing new process to come into the execution part, right? So that is actually good idea, that we can give fair chance to each and every process, but make sure we are not following a large value of time quantum. Otherwise, in that case, we are just executing our process is like FIFO, right? Because let's suppose we are keeping time quantum value is equal to 20. That means till 20 unit of execution, we are not able to have any other process meanwhile. So that is actually not a good idea. So we need to balance value of time quantum such a way that we are able to give fair chance to each and every process, right? So in that, each process gets a small unit of CPU time, usually 10 to 100 milliseconds. So after this time has elapsed, the process is preempted and added to the end of the ready queue, right? So for that, we are keeping one new thing called time quantum. So whenever value of time quantum is elapsed, we are just allowing new process to enter into the system and have their execution. So if time quantum is very large, that means we are just having same execution like FIFO. And if it is too small, that means queue must be large with respect to context switch. So if we are keeping queue, or you can say time quantum is very slow, so we need to have too many context switch, right? If you are keeping just one unit value as a time quantum, and let's suppose our process required 20 unit to complete, so it is required 20 time to do context switch. So that is again not a good idea. So we need to define time quantum in such a way we are having lesser overheading, as well as we are not just executing like a FIFO, right? So here is the example. Suppose our process required 10 unit to complete. That means 10 is nothing but you can say as a burst time. And in the first example, we have kept our time quantum value as a 12. So in that, we are not require any context switch. Why? Because our process required 10 unit to complete, and we have kept value of time quantum or TQ is equal to 12. So till 12 unit, we are not doing any context switching. So in that case, actually our algorithm is running like a FIFO. Whereas in a second, we have kept time quantum value is equal to 6. That means after 6 unit, we need to have context switch. So if our process is required 10 unit to complete, and we are keeping time quantum is equal to 6, that means our process require one time to have a context switch, right? And in the last, we have kept time quantum value is equal to 1. That means in that case, if our process require 10 unit to complete, that means from starting 0, our process require 9 times to have a context switch. So that is again not a good idea, right? So intermediate solution is better for our process. What to say? Yes. So let's have an example on this. In this example, we have kept time quantum value is equal to 4. That is actually given with your numerics data itself, right? So you are not required to decide. It is given with your data itself. So here we are having 3 process, and each and every process is having different burst time. So let's suppose all the processes are arriving at a 0. So we are directly starting from P1 itself, right? So as TQ is equal to 4, we are just executing P1 for the 4 unit itself, right? So we are starting P1 at a 0 and ending at a 4. So at a 4, we are having again two more process called P2 and P3, right? But as P2 is arriving first, we are executing P2 first, and as time quantum value is 4, but we just require 3 unit to complete, so we are just keeping 3 unit as execution part, and we are ending at a 7. Same way, now we are having P3 into the list as it is arriving first, right? So we are just completing P3 at a 10, and for the rest of the time we are just executing P1 by 4 as a time quantum. That means from this gain chart, we are actually ending our P1 at a 30, P3 at a 10, and P2 at a 7, right? So from that, you need to calculate average turnaround time and average burst time. average turnaround time and average waiting time. So quickly calculate this thing. So I hope you are getting the answer. Now we are having second example. Here we are having total 4 process, and each and every process is having different arrival time, right? So initially, as P1 is arriving at a 0, we are starting from the P1 itself. But as the TQ is equal to 4, we are just executing till 4 unit. So at execution P1 we are executing till 4 unit. Now at 4 we are having all process in the ready queue, right? But as P2 is arriving at a 1, first we are starting with the P2, and again we are executing till 4 unit. That means now P2 is completely completed, right? So at 8 P3 and P4 both are ready, but as P3 is arriving first, we are executing with P3. So again we are executing P3 for 4 unit, and that is how we are ending at a 12. Now at 12 we are having P4 in the queue, so we are executing with P4 till 16, and after that we are just completing with our pending work with P1, P3. Further at a 24 we are again having P4, and rest of the work we are able to complete by P3, right? So after each and every 4 unit of execution, you just need to focus whether at a particular ending time is there any process which is in a ready queue. So for that you need to follow this ready queue process, right? After that time you need to complete your pending execution, right? So I hope you are getting this Gantt chart. And from that we are having answer like this: average turnaround time and average waiting time. So here again let's verify what are the completion time of process. P1 is completing at 20, P2 is completing at 8, P3 is completed at 26, and P4 is completed at 25, right? So here you are having turnaround time and waiting time. So I hope you are getting this answer. Now one more example with having time quantum is equal to 20, right? And here we are having a process which is having somewhat large burst time. So again all processing are arriving at a zero. We are starting from P1 itself, right? So we are executing till 20 units, and after 20 we just need to remember what are the pending burst time of particular process. So at the same time P2 is ready, so we are executing till 20, but it is actually requires 17, so we are just executing till 17. That is how we are able to end at 37. So at 37 we are again executing P3, and after 20 unit we are ending at 57, and after that we are executing P4 and ending at 77, right? So further after 77 again in a ready queue we are having pending process called P1. So further we are executing P1 by 97, then P3 by 117, then P4 by 121. So after that P4 is completely completed, but still we are having P1 and P3 into the waiting queue. So first we are executing P1 and then we are executing P3. So like this we are able to complete our process as a completion time of P1 134, completion time of P2 is 37, completion time of P3 is 162, and completion time of P4 is 121. So from that just verify the answer, average turnaround time and average waiting time. So I hope you are getting this answer. Now note it down, this new example. You need to verify all the algorithm on this common example, like as we have seen FCFS, SJF with preemptive and non-preemptive, priority and round robin using time quantum is equal to 4, right? And just compare each and every algorithm in terms of waiting time, turnaround time and response time, right? And with your suggestion, what is the better algorithm to use, right? So this you need to prepare, and the answer you can mail me on this email ID. But before that, just note down this data. I hope you have noted down. You can email me on this email ID with your answer, and if you have any query, then most welcome on this email. Thank you everyone. Have a nice day.